I got so much pushback when I quit my job. And the thing is, most people give advice, or not advice, but most people react based on how they would react in your situation. And a lot of people don't have the risk tolerance, and that's okay. But it means that just because someone else thinks that what you do is crazy doesn't necessarily mean it's crazy for you.
The new school. This is The New School with your host, Christine Hong. Welcome to a new kind of school, where we talk about career paths you don't normally get to hear about in the classroom. Every episode, I talk to someone with an interesting life path and learn about how they got to where they are today. Hey, everyone. Thank you for joining us for another episode of the New School Podcast. This is actually our last episode before the holiday season, and I'm so excited to say we'll be ending with a banger. Our guest today is Kathryn Minshew, who's founder and CEO of The Muse, which is the go-to destination for the next-gen workforce to research companies and careers. This is such a special, amazing episode because Kathryn not only walks us through what it's like to be an entrepreneur and found a company, but also gives tons of career tips because that's what her company is all about. In this episode, Kathryn and I chat about her frustrations with job platforms before founding The Muse, the tough decisions she had to make to leave her stable job and found her first company, PYP, which later morphed into The Muse, and how the day-to-day of a CEO changes as your company grows. I seriously loved Kathryn's attitude on life and her insights. I just can't wait for you to hear this interview. Well, Kathryn, first of all, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here.
Yay. So if you had to describe your job to our audience, what would you say it is?
I am the founder and CEO of a company called The Muse, which I founded 9 years ago to help job seekers find the kind of best fit role and employers make hires. And so as the CEO and founder, I guess I do a little bit of everything. Sometimes I joke that I'm the chief cat herder.
Wait, what? Chief cat herder? You love her?
Yeah, like the herder of cats. Like I just feel like often when you're starting a business, you just do a tiny bit of everything all the time based on whatever the business needs.
Why do you think The Muse is different from other job platforms out there?
Well, I started it because I was so frustrated with other job platforms. You know, my own career was pretty winding. I had worked in global health, management consulting. I briefly thought I might, you know, be a career foreign service officer with the US State Department. And I was frustrated by how hard it was to figure out what you actually want to do. And so I had been on Indeed and Monster.com, which were the big job search sites at that point in time. And they just felt so transactional. And so I built The Muse to be the opposite of that. I wanted it to be all about helping you really understand the culture and values of a company before you joined, helping you get context on different career paths. And so everything about The Muse is built with the job seeker in mind. You know, every job listing on the site links to information about that company's workplace experience, testimonials from employees, pictures of the office. We work hard to understand what all of the challenges and pain points are of picking a career, finding a job, choosing a company that's a good fit. And then we've tried to build technology and product to help make that process easier.
That's awesome. I was wondering, what do you think are the biggest misconceptions about being a CEO and a founder?
There's so many. I mean, first of all, I think that sometimes from the outside, it can seem like a very glamorous job. And there are certainly pieces of it that are glamorous, especially when your company gets to a certain stage. You know, now that The Muse is a bit bigger and well-known, you know, we have 5 to 7 million people who come to the website every single month. So now, like, I'll get asked to speak at a conference in South Korea, or, you know, somebody will send me some free product to, you know, try out. But in the early days, being a CEO was just as much about like, oh my gosh, the, you know, bathroom's out of toilet paper. And like, I guess I better go get some because no one else is going to do it. It's about pitching in to solve any problem at any time. And I think the best CEOs, especially of early stage businesses, know that no task is too small. For every thing that I've done as part of my job that seems really cool or sexy, I've also had some, you know, insane late night working on a Saturday, trying to step in to fill a gap in the business that, you know, that sometimes you're totally unqualified to fill, and yet you might be the only one who can do it. It's the biggest learning and growth experience I've had in my entire life, but it's also been the most challenging.
I was kind of wondering, like, did you always think you wanted to found a company or be CEO?
Definitely not.
When you were growing up?
I had no idea this is where I would end up. In fact, my dad used to love to tell a story about how when I was probably 20 or 21 years old, we were having lunch and I got mad about something and I stood up and I was like, don't you know, I hate business. really did not think I was going to end up in this path. In fact, when I was really little, I wanted to be a superhero. But then I went through two big phases in my teenage years. For a couple of years, I wanted to be a professional actor or actress on Broadway. And for many years, I wanted to go work for the Foreign Service or the CIA and work in international geopolitics. And luckily, I had the chance to intern for the U.S. State Department in a U.S. embassy in Nicosia, Cyprus in 2007 in the Regional Security Office. And it was a totally fascinating experience. But I realized very quickly, like, oh my gosh, the idea I had of this career path is not at all the reality of what I'm doing day to day. And so from there, you know, I tried a couple different things. I did management consulting for a few years. I mentioned before that I worked in global health on vaccine introduction in Rwanda and Malawi. And getting involved in starting a company almost happened by accident because I found a problem that I loved and I started working on it and I loved it. But honestly, I really didn't think that I would go into business. I guess if you look at my background, I did start a few things when I was younger. I started a nonprofit that performed plays to kids and senior citizens. I started a few different things, but I just had this idea of tech and entrepreneurship and business that was very unappealing. And it wasn't really until I got close to it that I started to fall in love with what is now my career path, probably for the rest of my life.
Yeah, I saw the Muse wasn't your first company exactly. So what would you say was really your first company and what was starting that like?
Oh my goodness. It was probably around 2010. I was working at McKinsey & Company as a management consultant, and I knew I didn't want to be a consultant for the rest of my life, but I had no idea what I wanted to do. And so very briefly, my now co-founder, Alex, but we were just, you know, really good friends and colleagues at the time. We sort of flirted for about 6 weeks with the idea of a travel-focused company that would let people book experiences with locals in different cities. We posted an ad on Craigslist and hired an intern who is an NYU student. And we started to sketch out what the business model would look like, what we would call the company, you know, what sort of features would need to be in the first version of the product. But very quickly, about 6 weeks in, we realized, like, this is a cool idea, but neither of us are like long-term in love with it. And so we actually stopped working on it, went back to our jobs. And then a few months later, I was talking to a different woman at McKinsey who worked with me. And we started talking about how we felt professional women were really underserved, that, you know, we were part of this cohort of 20-something, 30-something women that wanted to be powerhouses, that wanted to, you know, have the corner office or build the career of their dreams, or at the very least, maybe just like get a raise. And that most women's content at that point in time wasn't serving us. And so I remember once we were riding in a car back from, we split a taxi on the way back from a bar. And she was like, you know, we should start a women's magazine for professional women to help them with their careers. And I was like, no, we should start a digital publication. And that was really where the idea for my first real business came from. It was called PYP. And four of us, my co-founder, Alex, who I'm still with at the Muse and who I did the travel thing with, and then this other woman and a fourth woman, we all did it together for about 10 months. And at the beginning, it was more like a side project. You know, the four of us kind of came together. We're like, we love this idea about, you know, building kind of community and content for professional women. But we didn't really know how to monetize it. We'd never done a startup before. We were all like 24, 25 years old. And so we said, well, let's do something in our nights and weekends and just see how it goes. So we bought a URL. We designed, you know, a very basic version of the site. I think we had a template online from WordPress that we maybe paid like $50 for. And then we customized and we just decided we're going to publish some career content. And when we finally pushed the site live, it was, I think, right around November 1st of 2010, the response was amazing. Even though, I mean, again, we didn't have any money. We didn't even really have a promotional plan. We just posted about it on Facebook and we asked some of our friends to share about it on Facebook. But so many women said, oh my goodness, this is what I need. I care about my career. I want fulfillment. I want meaning. I want to know how to navigate all these different office situations, job search situations, and no one else is helping me. And so even though our very first product, quote unquote product, it was basically a blog, to be honest, but it was a, you know, it was a community, it was a blog, et cetera. Our first product was really simple. It was ugly. If I showed you a picture, like, you would laugh so hard. It was very, very amateur hour, but we clearly identified that there was a need. And so over the next few months, the four of us continued to work nights and weekends. In January of 2011, me and one of the other women quit our jobs fully and went full time. And for me, that decision was a bit hard because I was about to just dive into just living off my savings. I had saved as much money as I could in my previous 2 years working at McKinsey that when I quit my job, I had about $25,000 in savings. That was also like, you know, every like birthday money I'd gotten for my whole life because I was a big, big saver. And so I said, okay, I can probably last for a year in New York City on this money. So I'm going to give myself 6 months to just go all in on this company. This was the first company, PYP. And in 6 months, if it's not working out, I'll pick my head up and I'll go get a job. And that way I felt like I didn't want to be stressing every single day. Did I make a terrible choice? And so I said, you know, this is a length of time. I'm just going to throw myself into it and not stress. And at the end of that period of time, I'll kind of, again, I'll pick my head up and I'll say, you know, should I keep working? Should I keep going on this entrepreneurial path or should I get a job? And I don't want to spoil the story, but basically that company like crashed and burned, but I loved it so much and I fell in love with the problem and I had much bigger and better ideas about how to build a job searching career product. And so that's what led to me starting the Muse. And actually, when I started the Muse, I was already in debt. And the first couple months were incredibly stressful because I really didn't know how we were going to sort of make it work financially. But at that point, I think I had enough conviction in the problem and in my own ability to create a solution and to figure it out that I dove in. And so, you know, it's definitely an unconventional path, but I often recommend to other founders that, you know, it's there's so much lore in startup space about how you have to like just quit your job and dive in right away. But I actually think it was really beneficial that I started working on this idea first as a side project. And if I could go back and redo my career, part of me thinks that I would have been better served working at a startup before I tried to start my own so that I would get some of that learning, you know, about building a technology company out of the way when I was still getting a paycheck versus really like learning everything, you know, when I was supporting myself out of my savings.
That's so funny. I feel so similar to you right now, like your beginning stages, because I left my job at Tinder in December after working on this side project for 6 months, because I was like, I'm not getting that much done on nights and weekends. So I've been working on my app full time for like almost like 10 months now. And I just released it last week and I was like, yeah.
Thank you.
So yeah, but I was just like, oh, I have enough savings to live for a year. So we'll just see what happens. But I got a lot of flack when I quit my job, and I quit my job later than I wanted to because people were like, are you crazy? Like, did you get things like that?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. And the thing is, look, there's no perfect time, right? Like if you wait too long, you feel like, oh my gosh, I could have done it earlier. If you quit too fast, you know, you might run out of money. And I think like I got so much pushback when I quit my job. And the thing is, most people give advice, or not advice, but most people react based on how they would react in your situation. And a lot of people don't have the risk tolerance, and that's okay. But it means that just because someone else thinks that what you do is crazy doesn't necessarily mean it's crazy for you. It might just be crazy for them with their circumstance, their set of, you know, hopes and dreams and fears. And I think that you do have to eventually take the plunge. Like I would never have been able to build this company if I hadn't been willing to let go of the safety of a paycheck and dive on in. But I do think it's a, you know, it's a decision that there's pros and cons to both sides. And I just always like to represent the perspective that, you know, it's good to do what you did, which is work on it first while you still have a paycheck if you can, because also that's where you learn. Do you really love the thing?
Right. If you're willing to work on it outside of work. Yeah. Okay. So you worked on it full time. And yeah, when you work on something full time, even on days you feel stuck, I've noticed like, even if I'm like, well, I just have no idea how to do this. But after a day or two of feeling stuck, you're like, well, you kind of just figure it out because there's nothing else to do. Like, I feel like if you have work, you're like, oh, I guess I'll just do work instead. But you said that it was not a failure after that first year savings, and you probably like discovered this at like the end of the year. So what did you do next? Did that immediately lead to the Muse, or what happened?
Well, the short version is that the business itself was just starting to click. We were starting to see the number of users grow. We were starting to figure out a business model, and we actually had a big co-founder blowout. And this is actually not uncommon. People often don't talk about it because it can, you know, it can feel like airing dirty laundry. And so it's a complex issue, but there were four of us that started this first business.
Did all four of you quit your jobs, by the way?
No, only two of us quit our jobs. So two of us were all in on the business and the other two were actually still working at McKinsey. Interestingly, that's not what led to the conflict, although that can certainly be a source of tension. We, I think, had very different views between, you know, Alex and I on one side and the other two on the other side. We had very different views about what sort of business we should be building. You know, is it for kind of an every woman, every man, or is it like very, very elite? We had differences in opinion on how the business should be structured. And then ultimately there were disagreements about what roles we should all have and how we should allocate ownership and equity. And all of that is very, very classic disagreements. But when we ultimately split, this was June, July of 2011. And, you know, at first I was devastated because I had just thrown myself into this business. At the time, it felt like everything I'd been working on since the last, you know, September was going up in flames. I was basically in debt. I had a few days where I was just in the fetal position. It was not a nice breakup. Let's just put it that way. I don't feel great about how I was treated and how Alex was treated. But you know what? That horrible experience ended up opening the door to us starting the Muse, because we looked at each other and we said, look, we still love this problem. We love working together. We believe that we're really onto something. I joke that there was a couple weeks, two or three weeks of alternating between the fetal position and the whiteboard. And then we started working on the Muse almost right away. And that took a huge leap of faith, because at that point I didn't have the financial cushion and we were sort of running on borrowed time. But I had never loved anything like I loved the idea of building this idea and this platform. I could see for the first time how much bigger it could be if we really built a modern job search tool and not just, you know, a sort of small content community. And I started to see the path to the business becoming really big. And so at that point, I was like, all right, I'm all in. I mean, I worked feverishly. I've probably never worked harder than in those first couple of years. You know, the perseverance paid off, because about 5 months later, we were able to raise our first little bit of seed money. And, you know, then the business took off from there.
Cool. So I guess when you raise your seed is when you like took a little sigh of relief. You're like, okay, I can live off this for now.
Sort of. Again, Alex and I are like, we were kind of insane as founders. So we basically said, what is the absolute minimum we can pay ourselves and still like eat? I mean, I am a freaking pro at not spending money. In the early days of the Muse, I used to go to tech events almost every weekday, partially because the networking was really useful and partially because I would eat dinner off of the appetizer trays. We paid ourselves $40K at first, which, you know, again, living in Manhattan and Brooklyn, you got to really stretch that. And I would pick up a bunch of business expenses. It was just enough to get, you know, to get the business further. And I think we were, first of all, we were still in our, you know, mid to late 20s. So we were kind of in a part of our lives where it was easier to be really thrifty. And I just, at that point, I thought, you know, every dollar that can go back into the business gets me closer to achieving our goals. And so we prioritized the company and, you know, the ability to hire our first employees and invest in a new URL for the business. And like all these little things, we prioritized that over paying ourselves, because we believed that if we built something great, you know, the payout would come down the line.
Hey everyone, just a quick break from this episode for a word from our sponsor, Obby. Obby is a podcast app that you can download now that I've been working on for almost a year. With Obby, you'll never have to search for podcasts again. Fill out a 1-minute profile on the app and you'll get a personalized playlist of podcast episodes made just for you. The playlist updates daily as it learns what you like, and you can play the episodes right from the app. You can find the link to download at heyobby.com. All right, thanks so much, guys. Back to the show now. I think this is a question a lot of potential founders have, but basically, like, it was your first time fundraising for a startup, like a seed round. Was it hard to figure that out? Like, what was that process like, figuring that out?
It was incredibly hard. And there wasn't a lot of content online like there is now about how to even pitch to investors. And so I mentioned before, I used to go to a lot of tech events after work. I would try and meet other founders so that I could ask them, you know, can you tell me how you raised your seed round? What worked for you? What didn't work for you? I tried to learn as much as possible from other founders so that I could make, you know, I could make new mistakes as opposed to existing, like the same old mistakes that other people had made before. And I also learned by trial and error. So the first couple pitches that I gave did not go well. In fact, I often now recommend to founders that they try and find some people to test out your early pitches on. That, you know, don't pick the investor of your dreams to go pitch to first or second, because it's just probably not going to be that good. And so, you know, I had to firstly learn by trial and error. I also started to recognize different patterns, such as I was very good and very comfortable pitching the Muse on stage. So when I got invited to a startup showcase or a pitch competition, I often did well, and I was able to pick up potential investors and kind of build relationships there. At the same time, when I met somebody in a coffee shop first, I was more likely to be treated like, you know, just a, for lack of better words, like a little girl. And, you know, that was one of the hard things as well. I mean, I think honestly, fundraising is just challenging no matter who you are, no matter what your business is. Some businesses have an easier time than others because they kind of hit on the zeitgeist or they hit into a particular theme. But generally, fundraising is very difficult. And then on top of that, if you don't look like a classic tech CEO, you know, if you're a different gender, a different race or ethnicity, a different ability, et cetera, a lot of people, even if they don't mean to, they bring all sorts of unintentional biases into that conversation. And so even though, you know, there were a lot of, I'm sure, really kind, you know, good-hearted mid-20s men getting funded for their seed round, a lot of people who met with me were like, oh, you seem too nice to be six. You know, you seem so sweet. Why not? Are you sure you want to do this? It's hard. And I'm like, very driven and very tough. But the way that tough and driven showed up in a 25, 26-year-old woman didn't always look the same as tough and driven in a 25 or 26-year-old man. And so, you know, I got turned down 148 times for our seed round before we ended up raising about $1 million. And that was not fun. You know, I dealt with self-doubt. I felt like I ate rejection for breakfast. But again, I believed so much in what I was building. And also it helped in a weird way. It helped that some of the rejections were just patently ridiculous. And that made them sting less. Like the smart, thoughtful investor who really looked at the business and took me seriously and treated me with respect and then decided not to invest, like that hurt because it made me feel like, what am I? Am I not good enough? What's wrong? But the asshole that just patronized me, patted me on the head, said something like, oh, I think monster.com's just fine. Or, you know, don't you think that your female users are going to quit this service after they, you know, have babies? And I was just like, are you? Do you know any women? Do you live in, like, you know, whatever, this was like 2011, 2012. But I was like, do you live in the present day? Of course, many women have amazing jobs and want to work. And those rejections just fueled me because I was like, you know, fuck you. I'm going to show you.
Wait, I love that. Yeah, that's so ridiculous. I'd be like, I mean, this is not me being bad. It's the investor sucking. Was there anything that was actually constructive that you like realized at the beginning, you're like, I am not pitching this right, to like how your final pitch that like finally got you to money?
There were a lot of things. One was that we didn't do a good enough job early on of articulating the business model. And a lot of investors, especially East Coast investors, really wanted to know, how are you going to make money? And being sort of vague and fuzzy, like, employers will pay for access. Okay, exactly. How will employers pay for access? And so we had to, you know, get a lot smarter about the specifics of who we would target, which kinds of businesses, what will we charge? Would it be recurring? And then I actually had to go out and get customers. I had our first paying customer in the second month that the Muse was live, partially because I think investors might have been willing to bet on someone else figuring it out. They weren't always willing to bet on me figure it out, but it was a good push for us to start monetizing early and figure out the business model. I also think my initial vision was really big and really broad. And in some ways, that's a beautiful thing, because back in 2011, I had a massive sort of idea for an entire system of job search and career products that would change how people found their next jobs. And also at the same point, it was sometimes hard to help an investor see all of the pieces. And it made them feel like I was not focused enough, or I was biting off more than I could chew. And so we also got some good feedback about how to really focus the idea, the first iteration of the idea, who it was for, who it served. The Muse right now, most of our users are millennial and Gen Z. But early on, I was hesitant to peg us that way. I wanted to say, well, you know, people of all ages could use this product. But I actually had a lot more fundraising success once I started to say, we're the next gen career platform for millennial and Gen Z talent. And, you know, I think that that sort of sharpening of elements of the pitch was very helpful. I'm sure there's 1,000 other things that people told me, because you do learn a lot while you're going through it. one of the challenging things, I think, as a particularly a first-time founder or entrepreneur, is really weighing which pieces of feedback do you need to internalize and consider and change in response to, and which pieces of feedback do you not? And, you know, it's sometimes easier if somebody is really rude about their feedback, but there's also a lot of really thoughtful, smart, kind people who tell you good ideas that are just not right for your business. And you've got to develop that sort of iron core inside that gives you the confidence to say, thank you for that. I've listened, I'm open to it, but I'm going to go in the direction that I believe is right.
I'm kind of wondering, what's your current day-to-day like now and how it's kind of like changed the past 9 years since you've had the Muse?
My day-to-day today is wildly different from the early days. So at this point, you know, the Muse has, I guess, about, I don't know, 60 to 70 full-time employees, and we're working remotely because of COVID. Although previous to the pandemic, we had a big office space in Midtown where most of the team worked out of. So, you know, today I got up in the morning. I had a couple of big projects I needed to work through on some kind of strategic imperatives for the Muse. I spent a couple hours emailing. I had several Zoom meetings with, you know, one with my finance team about our board deck, which is coming up on Thursday. You know, then I might have a meeting about comp strategy for a certain team, about how someone on the team is doing. You know, I'm constantly toggling between everything from like team and HR issues, investors and capital issues, our customers, revenue, sales team, et cetera, the product, which is a big area that I love spending time, you know, the marketing and the content teams. Like, I think one of the things I love about being CEO is that you have to span the whole business. You have to understand all of the different pieces. You don't necessarily understand them as well as the people who are close to it. And I think the humility of knowing that many people on your team have a perspective that might be different from yours. They might have better or just different information. Like, you have to sort of toggle the fact that you need to be on top of everything while also allowing for all of these different opinions and perspectives and data from all over the team. And I love that. And, you know, I think that in the very early days of a startup, the role of a founder or a CEO is very different in that often there's only, you know, one to three people. And that means you do everything. And so in the very early days of the Muse, there were three of us. It became four pretty quickly. And we sort of split up. Okay, so, you know, Melissa and Adrian ran the content part of the business. Alex handled the, you know, initial version of the website and was sort of the operational background, made the trains run on time, helped with early like payroll and any of that. And then my job was, you know, sales and early customers, partnerships, marketing, and like kind of setting and championing the big vision for the company and then getting investors excited about that vision. And so that meant that, you know, I was the marketing team and the sales team and the fundraising team and probably like five other hats. And it can be hard early on because most people are not experts in all of those things. And again, as soon as you have the resources to, it's amazing when you get to hire people who are so much better than you in a lot of the functional areas. But ideally, you know, you still become the connective tissue that knits all the different parts of the business together. This is definitely a job where you never have a dull moment, but there's also an intense amount of stress because you're making decisions with less information than you would like. You're making decisions that affect people's jobs and, you know, affect the whole business. And so I think the downside, or one of the downsides, is you just have to be comfortable being in some pretty high stress situations. And, you know, it also means sometimes you have to give up a lot of things in your personal life because it sounds so silly to be like, the business needs me, but it's not just the business. Sometimes it's like people's jobs and, you know, people's livelihoods. And I always, you know, want to do my best to be there for the people who work at the business, for our investors when they need something. So it's, you know, the job changes, but a lot of the emotional tenor of it, both the beauty and the challenge, has been in some ways very constant throughout the last 9 years.
I'm kind of wondering, what is your favorite thing about your job right now?
I'll give you two answers to that. One is, anytime somebody writes us or tells us or tells me that the Muse has changed their life, that is one of my absolute favorite things about my job. Getting to, you know, hear that someone left a job they hated and found a new position that's such a better fit. And, you know, every day they wake up excited to go to work because of the Muse. Like, that is such an incredible feeling. Before COVID, if I wore a Muse sweatshirt. Sometimes people would come up to me on the street and be like, I love the Muse. And like, let me tell you about how I use it. And like, aww, that is the best feeling because you came up with something in your brain and then your blood, sweat, and tears pushed it into the world. And then total strangers, you know, have the arc of their life changed because of something you did. And it's why I like also working on really meaningful problems because, you know, your career is so core to how so many of us spend our days. I think in a more tactical sense, you know, something I love about my job is how different every day is and how many different parts of the business I get to interact with. I love that I can spend an hour in the morning digging into a comprehensive marketing strategy and then an hour in the afternoon hearing about some of the, you know, pros and cons of a product initiative or technical architecture decisions. And then in the afternoon, I can get on the phone with a customer and understand their pain points, you know, and be on the line with our account management team as we talk about like what parts of the Muse's product are working for them and, you know, how we can kind of continue to work together. And I think it's just, I feel like it's a business boot camp and it's just a, you know, it's an incredible chance to, especially if you build a great team, to learn from incredible people and lead them pursuit of a big lofty goal that's very motivating.
I was wondering on the converse, what's the least favorite thing about your job right now?
I think the stress can sometimes be a challenge. I take the Muse extremely personally and I want it to do well. And so when something goes wrong or we don't deliver in the way that we should, or, you know, there's just a challenge in the business, it can really affect my mood. And I think that is hard because correlation between how much you care about something and how much it can hurt you. And so the beauty of caring so much about a company that you build is matched by, you know, its ability to cause pain. And I think you just have to be careful not to let the business become you in your mind. You have to remember that those two things are separate and that can be hard.
Awesome. Wait, so I've noticed for your public speakings, you've been really heavily featured as a career expert. It's probably because that's what your company's about. You even wrote a book on the topic called The Rules of Work, right? When did you start feeling like a career expert? I'm wondering, like, what does that feel like?
Well, it's funny. I always joke that I didn't start the Muse because I was an expert in careers. I started the Muse because I needed that expertise. And so people started asking me to give career advice very early, far, far before I felt like I was ready. And I always used to say, I'm not the best person to ask, but go to themuse.com. We have experts and career coaches who are providing answers to these questions. I think eventually I just gave up and realized that people expected and wanted me to have those perspectives. And luckily, since I've spent the last 9 years, you know, swimming in career coaches and talking to career experts all the time, I do now, and I did by the time I wrote my book, feel like I had a really good handle on a lot of the best of advice. So I would say it was probably, you know, 2 to 3 years into starting the business when I felt like I had gone deep enough and spent enough time. But that said, sometimes at conferences, people will still come up to me and they will have these like very specific, complex career questions. And I usually have to say, that is such a great question, but I'm probably not the best person to answer it. I run a career website. If you want to get deep into the details of career coaching, let me help you find someone who specializes in that.
Yeah. Is there any biggest mistake you think you've made in your career?
There are so many candidates for biggest mistake. I don't think anyone who strives for big things and tries to build something that's never been done before gets by without a whole litany of mistakes. I wish that I had made some hiring decisions differently. In some cases, when I didn't make a good hiring decision, I wish I'd recognized it sooner and changed it sooner. I wish I had been quicker to trust my own gut and intuition. Because I think the most painful mistakes are not the ones that I sort of fully made and owned. The most painful mistakes are the ones where my gut told me something was wrong and I didn't feel good. And I let someone else tell me, no, be quiet, you're wrong, pipe down, I've got this. And I was right all along. Those are the most painful ones because I knew better and I didn't trust myself.
Yeah, I totally agree. Those are the most painful mistakes, like ignoring yourself. Do you have any advice for anyone looking to become a founder and start their own company?
So one thing that I wish I had done is I wish I had worked at a smaller startup for a period of time, even just a year or maybe even consulted or freelanced for a period of time. But I think that there's so much that you can learn about startups from being close to them. And I didn't know any of that until I was in it. And in particular, I think it's helpful as a founder to separate out the kind of product or market innovation from the fundamentals of building a business. And what I mean by that is we always talk about, you know, building a startup, it's visionary, you have to think big. And that is true about your market, about your product, about how you serve your customers. But there are other basics, how you set up payroll, how you run a good hiring process that you don't necessarily need to reinvent the wheel on. And actually, if you either have experience or know people who can help you with kind of the just fundamentals of operations, of setting up and scaling a company, you are going to be so much more likely to be successful on the kind of product and market innovation side because you've got that really strong foundation.
And kind of special question for you, because this is what your company is about, but you know, our audience, they're looking to figure out what their passion is, like if they can make a living off it, how to turn into a career. Do you have any advice for our listeners out there?
Yes. Firstly, I would say that it's never too late to try something new. I think that, you know, now that I've been in this business for a long time, I've talked to people of all ages who are worried that they waited too long. It's like that old saying, you know, the best time for change was yesterday, but the second best time is right now. You know, we live in a world where there are so many different career paths, so many different options, and it can feel really overwhelming. So I definitely recommend that people try different career paths out if they can, either by shadowing somebody, doing an informational interview, even just watching videos of people or listening to a podcast of people in that role to make sure that it does sound like something you'd be excited by. But I think once you get that conviction that there is a career path that you want to move in, I would just say it's not too late. You've learned more than you think often in previous jobs. And I'd really encourage people to, you know, be willing to bet on themselves because you are your most valuable asset.
Oh, that's beautiful. Well, to wrap up this interview, we usually give our guests to promote something for a minute or two that they want to promote. So is there anything you'd like to promote today?
Well, I would love for anyone who's listening and wants to learn more to check out the Muse. It is my pride and joy. We have a newsletter as well as job alerts. So if you tell us, you know, what jobs you're looking for or what content you're interested in, we can help connect you to that. And then, yeah, I mean, you can follow me on Twitter, Instagram at Kamin or Kaminshew. And I'm just really happy to be here. So thank you so much for having me.
Yeah. Well, I know you wrote a book. So what is that about? Where could people find it?
Yeah. The book's called The New Rules of Work. It was published by Penguin Random House and the Crown imprint. You can find it at most local bookstores, Amazon.com, Barnes & Noble, you know, all the kind of major book retailers. And it's essentially a kind of modern guide to how to navigate your career. The first third is all about how do you figure out what you want? How do you assess your career values? How do you understand whether different career paths align with those values? The middle third is, you know, the basics of like, gosh, building a cover letter, creating a resume, interviewing, negotiating a salary. It's all of the best of tips from the Muse. And then at the very end, we talk a little bit about once you have a job, how to be successful. We were a Wall Street Journal national bestseller, which is a lot of fun. And yeah, we'd love to hear what people think and definitely encourage people to check it out and read the book.
Hey guys, I hope you enjoy listening to my talk with Kathryn Minshew as much as I enjoy chatting with her. So this is our last episode before the holiday break, but don't worry, we'll be back for the new year in January 2021. So from everyone here at the New School Podcast, we want to say thanks for listening and happy holidays. We'll see you soon. Make sure to check out our website at thenewschoolpodcast.com. You can find links to anything mentioned in the episode in our show notes and even suggest amazing new guests for the show. Also, be sure to subscribe to our newsletter. It's a weekly guide on how to turn your passions into a meaningful career that is guaranteed to be helpful for you and your career goals. Get every episode as soon as it drops by hitting the subscribe button to The New School wherever you get your podcasts. And if you have some free time, we would seriously, seriously love to hear from you by rating and reviewing us on Apple Podcasts. That will be an early Christmas present for us. Stay up to date with all things The New School by following us on Instagram at The New School Podcast and on Twitter at The New School Pod.
The New School with Christine Hong is produced by Jenny Snyder, Claire Whiteley, and Alexia Mersola. Editing by Sydney Salk, John Simpson, and Joseph Cho. Special thanks to our marketing team who help us spread our mission and put the New School name out there. Katie Osaki, Dina Che, Marissa Wolfsheimer, and Giovanni Cortez.